Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for Uachtaráin na hÉireann Mary McAleese, accompanied by her husband, Senator Martin McAleese. On behalf of the Irish Fire Service and the emergency services, we're here in Dublin Fire Brigade Training Centre to convey our solidarity with the New York City Fire Department and with the people of America on this, the 10th anniversary of the terrible events of September 11, 2001. We welcome the President and Senator McAleese, the American Ambassador and Mrs. Rooney, the Lord Mayor and Lady Mayoress, and you, our guests, and all the people who are following us on RTE television and on the internet. Today we light a candle in remembrance of all those who suffered and died in New York and in Pennsylvania and in the Pentagon. We're mindful of all the ordinary people who got caught up in this event, the stockbrokers, office workers, coffee makers, window washers, all who tried to help each other when this dreadful event happened. Also, we think of the emergency services personnel who rushed in to try and help them, and we think particularly of those who bravely tried to save other people's lives and sacrificed their own. Almost 3,000 people died on that day. Of them, there were 343 firefighters and 60 police.
Is one of those world events that I think are lasered onto our memories. For myself, I remember I was in my flat in London ironing in preparation for a trip to Ireland to join my partner who was dying of cancer at that time. And I had the television on with the sound turned down. And as I glanced at it, I thought there must be a disaster movie showing. But even without the sound, I could feel that there was something different about this. And with horror, I began to realize that this wasn't a film, but this was actually happening. I rang my partner immediately. With hindsight, I think that was a desperate attempt to be connected to someone I loved. I think this is a natural human response to disaster. And it's borne out by the many final phone calls people made from the burning towers to their loved ones. At a time like this, it's evident that what matters most is love. But beyond that, and after that, where do we turn and how do we cope? As someone who has meditated with the Brahma Kumaris for about 30 years, if I've learned anything about dealing with tragic life events, it's that the development over time of a connection with God, a universal benevolent energy, that is the one thing that sustains us at a time of need. In my experience, at a time of need, the mind seeks out that place of light, peace, and silence as a refuge. and fills itself with those qualities as a resource to face our challenges. Most people, when they start meditating, realize how busy the mind is, and that a lot of practice is needed to calm the mind and take it inward. Many of the great saints and mystics have talked of the sweetness of silence and the bliss that is experienced when one is able to find that space within. I have experienced that, and I believe that anyone can experience that. All that is necessary is the commitment to spend a little time every day training the conscious mind to get out of the way. I really hope that we don't face another atrocity like 9/11. Having said that, of course, people all over the world face tragedies every day: earthquakes, famine, war. Actually, in our lives too, in a microcosm of these great tragedies, we face our own tragedies. It could be the death of a loved one, or perhaps loss of health. And we need to identify ways to find the inner resources to deal with these. For me, it's meditation. For someone else, perhaps prayer will facilitate that. But however we do it, it will need to come from within.